Hello everyone and welcome to the first episode of Cut Rate Commander, the series in which we take a look at low price commanders and make budget decks with them. My name is Grazit and today we'll be looking at a Death Touch tribal deck led by a venomous commander from Kaldheim, Finn the Fangbearer. Let's start by taking a look at the commander. Finn the Fangbearer is a 1/3 human warrior with Death Touch that costs 1 or green with the following text. Whenever a creature you control with Death Touch deals combat damage to a player, that player gains 2 poison counters. A player with 10 or more poison counters loses the game. While Finn's low CMC, high toughness, and Death Touch make him a decent defensive creature, his real power comes from turning anything with Death Touch in your deck into legitimate threats that force your opponent into the difficult choice of blocking and losing their creatures, or letting the damage through and getting poison counters, which most decks have no way of interacting with. Unfortunately, Finn also has a hidden ability not listed in his text box, the ability to instantly make you public enemy number 1 at the table. Regardless of your board state, you will usually be considered a threat since instead of bringing your opponent's life from 40 to 0, your win condition is to give them 10 poison counters, which is arguably easier. As such, do not be surprised at the amount of aggro you will pull at the table when playing Finn as your commander, as many players have come to fear the win-out-of-nowhere capability of poison counters and will actively try to pick apart your board state or eliminate you from the game in order to prevent that from happening. So now that we know a bit about the commander, let's take a look at this deck's playstyle. Since our commander has such a low CMC, our game plan is to start aggressively, summoning efficient 1 and 2 drop Death Touch creatures to distribute as many poison counters as possible in the early game. Ideally, on turn 1, we want to drop a Death Touch creature, then drop our commander by turn 2 and swing our 1 drop at our opponent, distributing 2 poison counters to them. Then on turn 3, we swing both our creatures to our 2 other opponents to have 2 poison counters on each opponent. Now, while some of you may want to stack these counters on a single target to eliminate them from the game as quickly as possible, I would advise against this. From a tactical perspective, while removing a player from the game by turn 4 is certainly possible, this will inevitably turn the other 2 players against you immediately, resulting in an impromptu game of archenemy which you are not equipped to win. And then from an enjoyment perspective, you wouldn't want to be eliminated on turn 4 either, especially if the game still has a while to go. So I implore you not to be that guy and make another player at the table's life miserable while you still have other options. Instead, I would suggest spreading poison counters as evenly as possible to all players in the early game, as getting attacks through with your creatures may become harder once your opponents have established a board state and are capable and willing to trade with your Death Touch creatures. From there, our focus should switch to making sure our poison counters spread, either by making opportunistic attacks when our opponents have no blockers, avoiding blockers entirely by making our creatures evasive, or adding to existing poison counters via proliferate. Then we will be able to close out the game via sudden mass proliferation, a mass pump with trample, or multiple evasive Death Touchers. So now that we have a general idea of the deck's playstyle, let's begin breaking down the deck itself by starting with the creatures. Starting off in the CMC 1 slot, we have Wasteland Viper, Narnim Renegade, and Gnarlwood Dryad, all which are Death Touch creatures with upside. Wasteland Viper can be used as a combat trick and to grant Death Touch for a turn to a creature for surprise poison counters. Narnim Renegade can come in as a 2/3 if something of yours was destroyed, and Gnarlwood Dryad can come in as a 3/3 later on in the game due to Delirium. Then we have Moss Viper, Sedge Scorpion, and Tajuru Blightblade, all of which are 1/1s with Death Touch for early game poison and later game defense. Finally, rounding out the CMC 1 slot, we have Glistener Elf, a 1/1 with Infect. We'd prefer to have a Death Touch creature, but green is hard up for these, so we'll settle for this Infectious Elf as an early game play. As a bonus, if he can be granted Death Touch, it will deal its power plus 2 additional poison counters, thanks to our commander's effect and its own Infect keyword, which will apply to all Infect creatures in this deck. Moving along to our CMC 2 slot, we have Ambush Viper, Deadly Recluse, and Thornweald Archer. Ambush Viper is a 2/1 with Flash and Death Touch, allowing us the flexibility of playing it as a surprise blocker or on the turn just before it gets back to us for more Death Touch bodies on the board. Deadly Recluse and Thornweald Archer are a 1/2 and 2/1 respectively with Death Touch and Reach, granting us the ability to block flyers which would otherwise ignore our other blockers. Then we have Heir of the Wilds, Bitter Blade Warrior, and Nightshade Peddler. Heir of the Wilds is usually going to be a 2/2 Death Toucher, but depending on our board state can become a 3/3 on attack thanks to Ferocious. Bitter Blade Warrior is a 2/2 that gains +1/+0 and Death Touch when attacking if you exert it, making it a viable early play if your opening hand lacks any 1-drop Death Touchers before you play your commander. Nightshade Peddler is a 1-1 with Soul Bond, granting itself and another target creature Death Touch as long as both are alive, making it particularly good at granting infect creatures Death Touch or turning a utility creature into a threat for extra reach during the mid and late game. Then, to finish off the CMC 2 slot, we have Blight Mamba, a 1-1 infect creature with regenerate for 1 and a green, giving itself extra resiliency as long as you keep your mana open. The 3 CMC slot leads off with additional Death Touchers in the form of Skullwinder, Deathmist Raptor, and Turntimber Basilisk. Skullwinder is a 1-3 Death Toucher that allows us to recur one card from the graveyard at the cost of letting one of our opponents do the same, which is useful for getting back some of the win conditions we'll talk about later. Deathmist Raptor is a 3-3 with Death Touch, which we are mostly playing for the body, but we can get a counter on it with Megamorph to take advantage of Proliferate later on in the game. Turntimber Basilisk is a 2-1 with Death Touch and a landfall trigger that can force a creature to block it, which works well with ramp cards for forced 2-for-1 trades. Before we move away from the Death Touch in this slot, we'll need to talk about Hornet's Nest, a 0-2 with Defender that makes 1-1 flying insects with Death Touch depending on the amount of damage it takes. This hive makes a spectacular blocker, as many opponents won't want to risk gifting you evasive Death Touchers by kicking it. We are also including Viridian Betrayers and Viridian Corruptor as our additional sources of distributing poison counters in this slot. Viridian Betrayers is a 3-1, which will usually have infect due to this deck's ability to distribute poison counters in the early game, and Viridian Corruptor is a 2-2 with infect with the ability to destroy an artifact as an ETB, making it an excellent source of artifact spot removal while still being able to spread poison counters. Moving away from poison counters, we have some ramp creatures in the form of Farhaven Elf, Wood Elves, and Springbloom Druid. Farhaven Elf and Wood Elves are both 1-1s that allow us to ramp, the former putting a basic land into play tapped, while the latter searches for any forests and puts it into play untapped. Similarly, Springbloom Druid is another 1-1 that ramps us, but this time it destroys one of our lands to bring two basics into play tapped. Rounding out our ramp creatures, we have Fertilid, a 0-0 that comes into play with 2 +1/+1 counters and lets us pay 1 and a green and remove a counter to ramp for a basic land that comes into play tapped. By proliferating, we may get additional uses of this creature's ramp as the game progresses. Moving on to cards that care about counters, we have Evolution Sage and Malphist Revolutionary. Evolution Sage is a 2-3 that proliferates every time a land comes into play, greatly increasing the speed at which our poison spreads to all players. Malphist Revolutionary is a 3-3 with Trample that can increase the number of counters on target creature or player by 1 when it ETBs or dies, usually poison counters, but can be used with any other type of counter when applicable. Bringing up the rear in this slot, we have Reclamation Sage, Champion of Lampholt, and Monvuli Beast Tracker. Reclamation Sage is a 2-1 that allows us to destroy an artifact or enchantment as it ETBs for some good spot removal. Champion of Lampholt is a 1-1 that gets +1/+1 counters for each creature we play after it, and makes creatures unable to block if their power is less than it, making it great to allow our other creatures through when blockers are up. Finally, Monvuli Beast Tracker is a 2-1 that searches our deck for creatures with certain keywords, the ones we care about being Death Touch and occasionally Trample. The CMC4 slot starts us off with some card draw in the form of Toski, Bearer of Secrets, and Beast Whisperer. Beast Whisperer is a 2-3 that draws you a card for every creature you play, while Toski is a 1-1 indestructible creature that can't be countered and draws you a card every time a creature deals combat damage to a player. Both of these give us extra cards by doing exactly what we want to do in this deck, play creatures and hit face. Following up, there's Okam Adversary and Helena Kessick Ranger. Okam Adversary is a 2-3 with Death Touch that draws a card when it deals combat damage to a player. It also costs 2 less when another player controls a green permanent, so you should be able to play this at a discount a fair bit of the time. Helena Kessick Ranger is a 3-4 with reach that lets you pay 2 to have a creature who ETBs deal damage equal to its power to target creature, which does trigger that creature's Death Touch, effectively turning all your Death Touch creatures into removal spells if you have excess mana. Rounding out this slot, we have Magus of the Order, a 3-3 that lets us tap it, pay a green, and sack both it and another creature to bring any creature from our deck into play. A very slow card, but it can tutor for a few of your win conditions, so it's worth the risk of getting removed before it can go off. CMC5 sees only 2 creatures, Acidic Slime and Bellowing Tangleworm. Acidic Slime is a 2-2 with Death Touch that destroys target permanent when it ETBs, including lands, which makes it a good source of removal for many threats. Bellowing Tangleworm is a 4-4 with Intimidate that grants all other creatures you control Intimidate as well, making them blockable only by green and artifact creatures, which again lets us swing into established board states with relative safety. The CMC6 slot only has one member, that being Thunderfoot Baeloth, who is a 5/5 with trample that gives all of your other creatures +2/+2 in trample so long as you control your commander. The board-wide pump and trample are important because as long as our Death Touch creatures have trample, they only need to deal 1 damage to opposing blocking creatures, and they get to deal the remainder to the player, killing both blockers and dealing poison counters. Like the previous slot, CMC7 has only one member. Hornet Queen, a 2/2 flying insect with Death Touch that creates 4 other flying 1/1s with Death Touch when it ETBs. This creature alone generates enough evasive Death Touchers to kill any player with poison counters, making it a good top end for this deck. Now with the creatures done, let's move on to the instants. There are no instants in the CMC1 slot, so we'll move on to CMC2, starting with Ramthrough, which lets a creature deal damage equal to its power to target creature. Again, because so many of our creatures have Death Touch, this usually ends up being a destroy target creature spell for us. Just be aware that if the opponent is able to remove our creature, then the spell will fizzle. Then we have Heroic Intervention and Rapid Vigor. Heroic Intervention makes all our creatures indestructible and hexproof, while Rapid Vigor regenerates all our creatures. Both of these will help us maintain our board state if a board wipe gets played, and while Heroic Intervention is a bit pricey, it still falls within our budget and will provide us with the extra durability to make sure that our creatures stick around to continue spreading poison counters. Moving on to CMC3, we have a trio of removal spells in the form of Beast Within, Ambuscade, and Clear Shot. Beast Within lets us destroy any permanent at the cost of giving its controller a 3/3 beast, which is well worth the sheer amount of threats this all-star green removal spell can deal with. Ambuscade and Clear Shot both allow target creature to deal damage equal to its power to target creature, with the former adding +1/+0 and the latter adding +1/+1. Just like Ramthrough, they let our Death Touchers kill at range but can fizzle if our creatures are removed, so be wary of open mana when casting these. That wraps up our instance, so let's move on to the sorceries. Again, no 1 CMC spells in this slot, so we'll move on to 2 technically CMC2 spells in the form of Nylea's Intervention and Uncage the Menagerie. Nylea's Intervention costs X and 2 green and allows us to search for X land cards and put them into our hand, or deal twice X to all flying creatures. The land tutoring effect is nice because we are running a mono green deck, allowing us to play some good utility lands that this can fetch up for us, and while we will usually be playing this for the land tutoring, having the option to purge the Skies of Flyers is situationally useful depending on the matchup. Uncage the Menagerie also costs X and 2 green and lets us tutor to our hand X creatures that cost X with different names, so 1 CMC1 creature, 2 CMC2 creatures, etc. We are running a lot of CMC 2 and 3, so casting X equal to 2 or 3 is great for us, 2 if you're looking for some Death Touch or Infect creatures, and 3 if you're searching for Evolution Sage or some of your Ramp creatures to start proliferating. Moving on to the CMC 3 slot, we have some additional Ramp in the form of Cultivate, Nissa's Pilgrimage, and Harvest Season. Cultivate lets us search our deck for 2 basic lands, putting one into our hand and the other into play tapped, while Nissa's Pilgrimage does the same but only for basic forests, though occasionally it can get us an extra forest into hand if spell mastery is met. Harvest Season lets us put basic lands into play tapped equal to the amount of tapped creatures we have, which lends itself nicely to our early game aggressive playstyle. The CMC4 slot only has Harmonize, a simple but effective draw spell that lets us draw 3 cards with no additional hoops to jump through. The CMC5 slot continues granting us card advantage with Shared Summons and Shamanic Revelation. Shared Summons lets us tutor 2 creatures with different names from our deck to hand, letting us search for our finishers or utility creatures easily, while Shamanic Revelation draws us a card for each creature we control, taking advantage of our creature-heavy playstyle. Then we have Overrun, which gives all our creatures +3/+3 in trample until the end of the turn. Like Thunderfoot Baeloth, the Mass Trample and Pump will help our Death Touchers get in for lethal damage to close out games. Skipping over the CMC6 slot and going straight into 7, we have our last sorcery, Plain White Celebration, which lets us pick 4 of the following effects, allowing us to pick the same mode multiple times. Create a 2/2 citizen creature token that's all colors, return target permanent card from your graveyard to your hand, proliferate, or gain 4 life. This hefty spell will usually be used to close out games by picking Proliferate 4 times to give everyone 4 additional poison counters, but the other modes give us additional flexibility to establish a board presence, keep us alive, or recur our resources if needed. Now with the sorceries done, we can move on to enchantments. In the CMC 1 slot, we have Rancor, an aura which gives target creature +2/+0 and trample and reoccurs itself to hand when it leaves the field. Continuing our trample death touch shenanigans, this cheap little spell will help us push through for poison counters and keep coming back as our death touchers inevitably die. Skipping over to CMC 3, we have Snake Umbra, an aura which grants a creature +1/+1, and whenever it deals combat damage to an opponent, you may draw a card. Additionally, it will keep a creature alive thanks to Totem Armor if that creature is destroyed, at the cost of destroying itself, making it both a good source of card draw and protection. Lastly, in the CMC 4 slot, we have Court of Bounty, which gives us Monarch when it comes into play, and lets us put an additional land into play from our hand during our upkeep, or put a creature into play instead if we are the Monarch. Getting to be the Monarch is great for us, since our opponents will usually not want to swing into a board of Death Touchers, and the ability to play extra lands and free creatures is a great addition to this deck. Now with the enchantments done, let's move on to the artifacts. Moving straight into CMC 2, we have Contagion Clasp and Prowler's Helm. Contagion Clasp puts a -1/-1 counter on target creature when it ETBs and lets us pay 4 and tap it to proliferate, making it a continual source of proliferate for us to add both to our and our opponent's counters. Prowler's Helm is an equipment which makes it so that the equipped creature can't be blocked except by walls, allowing our Death Touchers to sneak in damage through well-established boards, except on the off chance that our opponents control a wall. CMC 3 gives us Lifecrafter's Bestiary, Ronus's Monument, and Whisper Silk Cloak. Lifecrafter's Bestiary lets us scry one on our upkeep and draw a card when we cast a creature spell by paying a green, giving us a fair bit of card selection and card draw as the game progresses. Ronus's Monument reduces the cost of all our green creatures by one, and whenever we cast a creature spell, another target creature gains +2/+2 in trample, again letting us abuse Death Touch Tramplers to punch through blockers and deliver poison counters. Whisper Silk Cloak, on the other hand, is an equipment which makes the equipped creature unblockable and grants it Shroud, bypassing blockers altogether and giving it some reliable protection from targeted removal. Which brings us to the last member of the artifact slot, Bow of Nylea, which grants all our attacking creatures Death Touch and can be tapped for one in a green for one of the following effects. Put a +1/+1 counter on target creature, deal 2 damage to a flyer, gain 3 life, or put 4 cards from our grave onto the bottom of our deck in any order. The static ability of this artifact is spectacular, making any utility creatures into threats the instant it comes down. The tap ability is also useful, giving us a fair selection of narrow use abilities to pick from, though the most common one for us will be adding +1/+1 counters to take advantage of proliferate. That's artifacts done, so let's move on to planeswalkers. There's only one member in this slot, the CMC 3 Vivian, Champion of the Wilds. She comes into play with 4 loyalty and the static ability that lets us play all our creatures at flash speed. Her +1 grants a creature vigilance and reach until the end of our next turn, and her -2 lets us look at the top 3 cards of our deck, exiling one and putting the rest at the bottom. Then, as long as it remains exiled and it's a creature card, we can cast it. Being able to play creatures on our opponent's turn is great, effectively turning all our Death Touchers into Ambush Vipers. Her +1 is a good defensive option, allowing our creatures to still block after swinging and letting it block flyers to boot. The -2 ability is also great, since we'll be having so many creatures in this deck it will usually hit something we can use, and the card can still be cast even if Vivian is destroyed at a later turn. With our Planeswalker covered, let's go ahead and talk about the lands. Starting off, we have Arch of Araska and War Room. Arch of Araska taps for a colorless, and if we have the City's Blessing, we can tap it and pay 5 to draw a card. War Room also taps for a colorless, but it only costs 3 to tap it and draw a card. However, it deals damage to us equal to the color identity of our commander, in this case, 1. While both of these do not have the best rates for card draw, they can be put into this deck for minimal investment, as we are a monocolored deck and don't need to worry about fixing. Additionally, they provide a mana sink for later additional card draw that we normally wouldn't have access to on our lands. Then we have Blighted Woodland and Myriad Landscape, both which tap for a colorless and get us 2 basic lands into play tapped by sacking themselves, the former costing us 3 and a green to do this, while the latter costs only 2 but comes into play tapped. Not much to say here, just some additional ramp in the land card slot to help us keep making our land drops as the game progresses. Following up, we have Ghost Quarter and Scavenger Grounds. Ghost Quarter taps for a colorless and can also be tapped and sacked to destroy target land, giving us some spot removal for our opponent's utility lands, though they do get to replace the destroyed land with a basic. Scavenger Grounds also taps for a colorless, and we can pay 2, tap it and sack it, to exile all cards from all graveyards, providing us with Graveyard Hate to combat against graveyard-focused decks. Then, to further our own game plan, we're running Karn's Bastion and Rogue's Passage. Karn's Bastion taps for a colorless, and we can pay 4 and tap it to proliferate, giving us a much-needed proliferate source on our land slot to continue spreading our poison counters. Rogue's Passage also taps for a colorless, and you can pay 4 and tap it to make target creature unblockable, giving our Death Touchers an additional way to bypass blockers. Finally, we finish up the deck with 28 basic forests. So now that we've seen the deck, let's look at the breakdown. This deck currently has 39 creatures including the commander, 6 instants, 10 sorceries, 3 enchantments, 6 artifacts, 1 planeswalker, and 36 lands. Looking at the stats that matter to our game plan, we have 19 cards with the Death Touch keyword or the ability to generate it on the board in some way, 4 cards with infect, 2 cards able to grant the Death Touch keyword, 5 sources of adding additional poison counters, 4 sources that grant trample, and 4 sources that grant unblockable or unblockable-like effects. This gives us a good amount of sources of poison counters through our commander's ability or through their own means, multiple ways to get through or avoid blockers entirely, and options to increase poison counters by ways other than attacking. For general deck stats, we have 10 sources of ramp, 11 sources of card draw, 4 tutors, 10 targeted removal sources, 1 board wipe, and 2 board wipe protection sources. Ramp and card draw are just about in the right ratio where we want to see them, which lies around 10. The 4 tutors, most of which grab more than one card, will help us with our consistency in closing out games. 10 targeted removal is a bit high, but this is to make up for the fact that we only have 1 board wipe, and it's a situational one at that. I would have liked to have seen a more even 5-5 split, but Mono Green doesn't really have a good selection of board wipes to choose from. But what we do have is some board wipe protection cards that will hopefully let us live through our opponent's board wipes and get in for lethal damage when it gets back to us. Looking at our mana curve, we have 8 1-drops, 15 2-drops, 27 3-drops, 7 4-drops, 4 5-drops, 1 6-drop, and 2 7-drops, giving us a very aggressive early to mid-game mana curve with a handful of higher CMC cards to help us close out games. Currently, this deck is valued at $64.05, not counting the price of basic lands. This price was calculated by using the cheapest listed marketplace price at TCG Player at time of this recording. If you're looking for some side grades, this deck already has a fair bit of elves, so you can swap out some creatures to add Wren's Run Vanquisher, Pollenbright Druid, and Elvish Warmaster to lean more into that aspect. Alternatively, swapping out the basic forests for snow forests lets you play with some additional cards that care about counters such as Blessing of Frost and Boreal Outrider, as well as another effective fight effect in the form of Blizzard Brawl. For upgrades, you have the usual suspects of the Great Henge and Guardian Project for great card draw. Orin Frostfang is also a great addition to this deck, but price has increased since Finn was announced, so I would personally wait for a reprint. Triumph of the Hordes is also a good addition to win games out of nowhere, effectively granting all your Death Touch creatures super infect, dealing their power plus 2 poison counters if they connect with a player, though that may cost you some friendships. Hey folks, thanks for sticking around until the end of the video. I had a lot of fun making this, and if you like what you saw, please consider liking and commenting down below on how you would build this deck. Any feedback would also be appreciated, as this is my first time building a deck tech, and any constructive criticism would be appreciated. Also, let me know what commander deck you'd like me to make a cut-rate commander's video on in the comments. Otherwise, have a good one, folks, and stay safe.